knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned about fluvial processes, which primarily have to do with the weathering effect of flowing water on rocks and minerals. Aeolian weathering involves the transportation, erosion, and deposition of sand and silt by wind. The term Aeolian comes from the Greek god of wind, Aeolus. The movement of sediment by wind is much like the movement of sediment by water, requiring a certain velocity to move a certain grain size. Due to the nearly 1,000-fold lower density of air when compared with water, the wind velocities found on Earth are unable to carry any sediment larger than coarse sand. But here, just like with fluvial environments, sediment can be transported by traction, saltation, and suspension. Sediments larger than 500 microns are rolled along the ground and slowly creep forward. Sand-sized sediments move in a series of short hops called saltation that knocks off small silt-sized particles into the wind. Very small sediments, less than 70 microns, are either suspended in the air for short distances or remain in suspension. Wind erosion is caused by two processes, abrasion and deflation. Abrasion is a mechanical weathering process that causes larger particles to break down into smaller ones from repeated impacts by sediment suspended in the air. Ventifacts are pits, etched lines, grooves, or even polish marks on larger rocks caused by abrasion. Deflation is the removal of loose sediment from an area by wind. Once sediment has been eroded and transported by wind, it is deposited in a variety of landforms in a way that depends on its grain size. Sand forms ripples and dunes, which are basically different-sized versions of the same thing. In Aeolian environments, ripples often form on the backs of dunes. Any sediment smaller than sand simply forms parallel horizontal deposits. Sand dunes come in four main types: transverse, parabolic, longitudinal, and star. The type of sand dune that forms is dependent upon the wind direction. Transverse and parabolic dunes are similar to ripples in that they form perpendicular to the prevailing wind direction, which mostly blows in one primary direction. The difference between the two is that transverse dunes have straight crests and parabolic dunes have parabolic or curved crests. In these dunes, sand is eroded on the windward side because the velocity is higher. The sand is transported over the crest and deposited on the steeper leeward or lee side, where the wind blows more slowly. On the other hand, longitudinal dunes form parallel to the direction of the wind, which is also the direction that the sand is transported. Longitudinal dunes tend to form in areas where there are two dominant wind directions that are separated by about 90 degrees. And finally, star dunes have a starfish shape and occur in environments that have more than two main wind directions. For those who were not even aware that multiple types of sand dunes were possible, this could give anyone a lot more to think about when looking at a landscape like this, imagining all of the weathering that is going on at all times to produce these structures. Interestingly, beyond being a widespread feature of deserts on Earth, dunes also appear to occur on other worlds in the solar system. Though Mars has a very thin atmosphere, it has sufficient wind to physically weather its basaltic bedrock and mold the resulting sediment into dunes. This image shows Martian Barkan dunes, a type of parabolic dune. As we can immediately surmise, the wind is blowing toward the upper right corner. Additionally, notice the smaller longitudinal dunes on the backs of some of the larger dunes. An even more exotic example of extraterrestrial dunes was found during the 1997 Cassini-Huygens mission, which provided fascinating observations of Saturn's moon Titan. The Cassini probe collected hundreds of high-resolution images of Titan's surface, revealing the presence of lakes that appear to be fed by an extensive system of river channels, much like Earth. However, unlike Earth, Titan's lakes are filled with liquid hydrocarbons, likely a mix of methane and ethane. The presence of lakes and river channels indicates that Titan has a hydrological cycle, but with methane and ethane instead of water. Cassini also found large subaerial dune fields in Titan's lower latitudes. These dunes are not composed of silicate sand like on Earth, but small fragments of water ice derived from Titan's bedrock. And with that, we have covered both fluvial and aeolian processes, which leaves just one more weathering environment to cover. So let's move forward and wrap things up by looking at glacial processes.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.